Good evening, guys, to our episode of Young India Intensivist Webinars. The topic for today is acidosis and alkalosis, that is ABG. So this is part two of ABG. I had taken an earlier session on ABG, which covered more basic stuff. This is more advanced and very comprehensive. And in the earlier one, I had actually not covered acidosis and alkalosis in too much detail. So the focus here is on acidosis and alkalosis, and it is practically everything in these two parts of ABG. Part one and part two, if you go through, you will practically know everything about ABG. So ABG is a complex topic, and you know, there are a lot of queries we have. I always had when I was growing up, and had to look up various sources because it's very difficult to find it in one place. So I've tried to put it up together for you. And hopefully with these two ABGs, the one I'm going to talk about and the one earlier, if you go through these two, you will get the entire ABG and many of your queries will be solved. So I will start now, and you can put your questions in the chat box. So there are a lot of slides, and it might be a lengthy one till the end, and I might take a 2-minute break in between. So stay tuned and let us get started. I will just share the screen. So friends, as you know, we also have our YouTube channel, and part one is available on that. And many of you are seeing this for the first time. So we conduct the webinars every Sunday from 5 to 7. So this is just a shot of the first lecture that I had taken. And this is now going to be part two. So the references for whatever I'm going to tell you are the various textbooks: Nephrology, Brenner's, Harrison's, Guyton's Physiology, New England Journal of Medicine articles, and many other articles. Because we have to base our understanding and our concepts on evidence. So what are the key learning points in this session? So this is some of the points I'll be covering, and of course there'll be other things also, and hopefully you shall be able to solve the ABGs. Now this is a pre-test ABG. If you guys can solve this, then you are very good at ABG, and try to answer this and see what your answer is. I will put this up again at the end of the lecture and see if your answer is the same or any different, and try to figure out if you are wrong now, where you were wrong. So this is called pre-test and post-test, and is one of the ways to assess how good or how bad your lecture is in terms of delivering the concepts and making the audience understand what you are saying, and it's a way forward towards medical education. So have a look at this and see what is the answer. Write the answer, 1, 2, 3, 4, there's only one correct response. I will put it up again at the end. Another 2 minutes. Okay, so we will move on now and see the question again at the end. So first, to give you a little bit about the history, you know, we had this great polio epidemic in Denmark in 1954, which is integral to critical care medicine, because that is the birth of critical care medicine. There was no critical care medicine prior to that, and it was with the onset of the polio epidemic that we had the first ABG machine constructed, the first positive pressure ventilators, and the establishment of the first intensive care units. So what is the connection between the polio epidemic and ABG? So now the connection is that when these patients of polio developed respiratory failure because of neuromuscular failure, they could measure the serum biochemistry in which they got the bicarb, which was found to be high because there was type 2 respiratory failure, and as a compensation, the bicarbonate was high. So erroneously, these patients were thought to have a high bicarb, which was causing the respiratory failure rather than the bicarb being high due to the respiratory failure. The understanding was not there at that time. So there was this anesthesiologist, Ispin, who had worked at Massachusetts General Hospital and had given curare to a patient of tetanus and seen similar situations. So he thought that probably the CO2 and HCO3 were linked, and thereby these guys got together. Ispin was the anesthesiologist, and the chief of laboratories there in Denmark, his name was Paul Astrup, and the others had a meeting because it was a major epidemic, and they couldn't do anything because positive pressure ventilation was not there, and patients were in respiratory failure. So what happened was they thought that there was a connection between PCO2 and HCO3, and they analyzed it, and thereafter they used the Henderson-Hasselbeck equation, and it led to the development of arterial blood gas concept and the machine. So that is the history of arterial blood gas analysis. Today, from that particular period, we have moved on to the most sophisticated and automated blood gas analyzers. Of course, there are lots of machines, and some are really good, some are not that good, and they need adequate calibration. That is very important, because sometimes they're not calibrated and your ABG values are haywire. So I'll be showing you some examples. Many of these examples are real. Some are made up just to show the concept. So have a look at this ABG and see if the ABG is normal or abnormal. So it looks normal, right? Everything is normal by and large, but it is not a normal ABG. Now you need to calculate the anion gap, and if you see, the anion gap is increased. So at its face value, it looks normal, but we don't calculate the anion gap, and sometimes it is not there in the ABG reading. So the anion gap should always be calculated. And when the anion gap is elevated and the ABG is showing near normal values, it means there's a mixed acidosis and alkalosis. Now, the next question is, how many acid-base disorders can be there in an ABG? So the answer here is there can be 3 disorders maximum. As you can see here, if the PCO2 goes up to 45 and the pH then drops to 7.32 and the rest remains more or less the same in this patient, he gets a combined metabolic acidosis, metabolic alkalosis with respiratory acidosis, right? So you can get a maximum of three disorders in an ABG. Now, this is another example. So this example, alcoholic with vomiting. And you can see here, the anion gap is 15. Now, the same patient, he's a diabetic patient and he goes into DK. So if he goes into DK, now this is the ABG. Okay? Please kindly mute.
First time. इस काकी वाले को डर लगने लगा। मेरी बेटी।
Kindly mute everybody. Somebody is disturbing this man.
डर लग रहा था।
Okay, so the PCO2 has gone down and the SCO3 has gone down because he has developed DK. Now, the idea here is to show you the incongruencies and the difficult situations we encounter. This is delta gap. Delta gap, as you all know, I should be knowing because I assume you know the basics of ABG. Part one have covered the basics and you always do ABGs. You are mostly intensivists, many of you, and you see ABGs day in and out. So you should be knowing a little bit about the ABG, the basics. So I will not cover that. So here the delta gap is 15 by 0. Now that is an infinite number, right? So that seems impractical, but that is the way it is. And this is a real example taken from Brenner's nephrology, which is the Bible of nephrology. And ABG actually in detail, if you actually go into in detail, it is nephrology, kidney. Kidney is the organ for acidosis and alkalosis. Okay. So 15 by 0 is an infinite number. You don't divide anything by 0. But this is the situation here. And there are certain more incongruencies which we shall cover. Now, coming to the methods of ABG analysis, there is a physiological method, which is the method which we use and which we'll be discussing. Then there's the Stewart's or the physiochemical method, which many of you have heard about, but are not really using and probably do not know the details also. And then there's a standard base excess, which has its own limitations. The Stewart's method is nothing new. It has been there for 20, 30 years. It was developed by Stewart's and is supposed to give more information. Okay. But it is much more complex in sorting out the ABG. And the critics say that it does not alter the outcome of the patient, but it gives more information and is more accurate to some extent. But at the end of the day, is the physiological method, which is being used in most of the places, including at Harvard Medical School and other places. Though some people do use Stewart's, they are proponents and opponents. Now, one very important thing about the ABG is that you should know the details of the patient. If you are given an ABG, let's say in the exam, okay, many of you will be taking exams, you should always ask for the history. Because just to look at the ABG and say that this is the diagnosis on the ABG is many a times wrong. For example, you have to know whether the disease is acute or chronic. Very simple. You have to know some basic disorders, whether he has renal failure, whether he is COPD, right? So the ABG has to be taken in conjunction with the history. And when you evaluate ABGs, serial ABG evaluation is very important also. You have to sometimes compare with the previous ABG. For example, if the patient has developed a new onset alkalosis, you are not being able to explain, has he received diuretic 12 hours ago? So the ABG has to be taken in conjunction with the history. It is actually wrong to diagnose the ABG without the history. You can do it at times, but you should know the history. Now coming to the components of ABG. So if you look at the components, a very important component is temperature right here. Have you ever wondered what does this mean? We all know that this is what the ABG reads, temperature 37 degrees. But does it have any bearing? So I will just tell you about the temperature. This all I'll discuss what is actual standard base excess blood, base excess CCF. Many of you would probably not know what is the difference, okay? Which base to use and et cetera, et cetera. And then any important component, which again, you may not have realized is this. This is methemoglobinemia. This gives the amount of methemoglobin in the blood. And you get methemoglobinemia at times in poisonings. And if you can see here, and if your machine is correct, you can get your value here and know whether the patient has methemoglobinemia. And it occurs sometimes. Recently, we had a patient of dapsone poisoning, and we used this value to treat the patient. And then you go down, this is probably familiar to all of you. Okay, but calibration of ABG has to be done 6 hourly. And if you are in any doubt, you recheck with the lab whether he is calibrating the ABG or not. Now moving on to temperature. So the temperature is important because some of you would probably know, as many of you are having an anesthesia background, that the gas solubility and partial pressure changes with temperature, right? At different temperatures, there is different gas solubility and partial pressure. And you can see in the table that at 36 degrees, the PCO2 has dropped from 40 to 38, and PO2 has dropped from 80 to 75. So, you know, we often use hypothermia in our ICUs. Now, the temperature is sometimes 33, 34, depending on the situation. You know, therapeutic hypothermia is used for CPR now all the time. And we are using it in certain other situations, whether evidence-based or not as yet, that only time will tell. So now the PCO2 value is changing and the PO2 is also changing. Now the PCO2 becomes very important because we often target the PCO2 to hyperventilate, or the PCO2 value change influences the cerebral vasodilatation and the intracranial tension. So it is important to correlate it to the temperature. That is the concept. How you use it depends on you. But you may alter the ventilator settings in patients with raised ICT if you are not aware of the temperature difference and the effect the temperature has on the ABG values. Now, most of the machines measure the temperature, the ABG PO2s and the PCO2s at 37 degrees centigrade. They do not correct for hypothermia. And whether we should correct for hypothermia or not correct, there is no consensus on this. But the concept should be known to you. Now, this is a beautiful painting. Very nice to see. And for those of you who are well-versed with paintings, probably know the painter. He's the greatest painter we've had, Vincent van Gogh, who lived in the 1800s, late 1800s. And I'm a particular fan of his. And the reason why I put this up is because this conjures up the image of food, right? Obviously. though the tables are empty, but that is what it is. Now, what relevance does food have to acidosis and alkalosis? The relevance is that we generate acid when we take in food. The metabolism of food, which leads to production of ATP, generates acid. And it is this acid that the body has to handle daily. It is not alkali that we have to handle. The body has to handle additional acid load, which is produced during the metabolism of food. That is why I put this besides the point that it's a beautiful painting. Now, around 80 milliequivalents per day of acid is produced every day. And in normal physiology, this acid is to some extent blown away in carbon dioxide, right? You get hydrogen ions and that combines with bicarbonate, you get water, you get carbon dioxide, and carbon dioxide is blown out. Then you get some organic acids, sulfuric acid, and phosphoric acid. These are the main acids you get, and these are excreted in the kidney. So in a nutshell, in a normal physiology, body daily produces around 80 milliequivalents, maybe more, maybe less, depending on your diet. And this acid load is partially blown away by carbon dioxide when you breathe out, and the rest of it goes through the kidney. And the derangements that we shall discuss as we go on are based on this physiology. This is normal physiology. The body has to deal daily with 80 milliequivalents of acid. And when these 80 milliequivalents are neutralized, one is the carbon dioxide, it is blown out, fair enough. The other is bicarbonate. Now the bicarbonate is consumed, okay? It reacts with hydrogen. Now you have to produce more bicarbonate every day because it is being consumed, right? A certain amount of bicarbonate is consumed daily in neutralizing the acid. So you have to regenerate this bicarbonate. That process occurs in the kidney. The kidney regenerates bicarbonate daily, which is consumed in neutralizing part of the acid load. So I hope that was clear about the physiology. Now moving forward, this is a very fundamental equation which I was talking about, and this is the balance of acidosis and alkalosis, that is the pH. So this is hydrogen ions which are added. Now this is a physiological process, or let's say any metabolic acidosis which is occurring in the body. And your bicarbonate goes down and your CO2 has to go down to maintain electroneutrality in terms of the pH. That is what happens. If excess hydrogen ions are added, now we are talking about a disease process. There is metabolic acidosis, hydrogen ions are being added, so the bicarbonate goes down, metabolic acidosis. And what happens in metabolic acidosis? As compensation, the PCO2 gets blown out. Similarly, the other changes will occur. So this balance has to be maintained in the body. This is a fundamental equation. And the Henderson-Hasselbeck equation is based on this, which we shall see now. This is the Henderson-Hasselbeck equation, just in a short form. pH is directly proportional to HCO3 by CO2. If the HCO3 increases by 20%, as a response, the CO2 goes up by 20%, your pH is maintained. Very simple. That is what happens. Metabolic alkalosis, HCO3 goes up, and as a compensation, your CO2 goes up. In metabolic acidosis, HCO3 goes down. As a compensation, CO2 goes down. So the pH is maintained. Now the question is, the pH is actually a measurement of hydrogen ions. It is not bicarbonate or carbon dioxide. It is very important to realize pH measures the hydrogen ions. And why don't we use the hydrogen ions then? Why do we talk about pH? It is because the hydrogen ion concentration as such is very, very, very low. That is the number. So to talk about such low numbers would be problematic. To simplify it, we have used pH, which is log of hydrogen ions. Now, it is also important to realize that the pH has to be maintained between 7.35 to 7.45 because that is key to the reactions, the chemical reactions which occur intracellularly. That is why the body homeostasis tries to maintain a normal pH for normal intracellular functioning. And the limits for survival are a pH of 6.8 to 7.8. Body can survive between 6.8 to 7.8 pH, the extreme limits recorded for survival in human beings. Now, we shall move on to the pathological processes. We have to buffer the acidosis and the alkalosis or whatever chemical reactions that are taking place. So we all know bicarbonate is a buffer, but that is not the only buffer in the human body. Let us see what all buffers. So these are the buffering systems in the human body. The chemical buffer system is the instantaneous buffer system and consists of bicarbonate and hemoglobin and other intracellular proteins. This is the immediate buffer. As the pH is changing, this buffers. Then you have the respiratory buffer in terms of your carbon dioxide either being retained or blown out. And then you have the renal buffer, which is the final buffer, which gives you the compensation, the complete compensation to your acidosis and alkalosis. So this is just to show you hemoglobin as a buffer. And hemoglobin is a very important buffer. Carbon dioxide goes up and you can see what is happening. I shall subsequently discuss this when we move forward, what happens in respiratory acidosis. But this is just to show you how hemoglobin is binding the hydrogen ion. Now, what are the intracellular buffers? They are hemoglobin, tissue proteins, organophosphorus compounds, and bone. Bone is also very important, especially in chronic renal failure and other chronic conditions which may lead to acidosis. Now, when you talk about pH, we talk about extracellular pH. What about intracellular pH? The intracellular pH is just a little less than the extracellular pH in most of the tissues. So we talked about the chemical buffering. Now this is the respiratory buffering. So what happens in respiratory buffering is that the carbon dioxide is either blown out or retained. And the medulla in the brain is the respiratory center, which responds to changes in carbon dioxide and hydrogen ions. So that is the respiratory buffer. And this is the ultimate buffer, the kidney, because kidney provides the full compensation for buffer in chronic and acute diseases to some extent, but mostly in chronic diseases. Kidney is the organ which provides buffering in chronic respiratory acidosis and chronic respiratory alkalosis. It is the major buffer. So this is very important. And also, it is very important to realize that in acute processes, that is acute respiratory alkalosis and acute respiratory alkalosis, the buffer that is done is not able to return the pH to normal. The pH does not return to normal in acute respiratory acidosis and alkalosis. It only stops it to some extent from dropping or increasing the pH. Similarly, in metabolic acidosis and alkalosis, the buffering that is done does not return the pH to normal. The pH returns to normal only in chronic respiratory acidosis and chronic respiratory alkalosis. And the kidney has a very big role to play in full compensation, which takes two to five days. Because the process is slow. Why does it take 2 to 5 days? Because the process is slow. It is not immediately in the kidney. The changes that take place take a little while to act upon the kidney. But the respiratory buffering is immediate, within minutes to hours. Within minutes to hours. So this is actually a schema of the proximal convoluted tubule where the filtered bicarbonate is absorbed. You know, when there is a ultrafiltrate, that is when the plasma gets filtered through the glomeruli and reaches the proximal tubules, bicarbonate which is there in the blood is obviously filtered through. So you cannot lose that bicarbonate. So that bicarbonate is absorbed in the proximal convoluted tubule, and regeneration of bicarbonate, which was consumed in neutralizing the hydrogen ions which are produced daily from the metabolic processes, is done in the distal convoluted tubule. So the proximal convoluted tubule absorbs the filtered bicarbonate, and distal convoluted tubule reclaims the bicarbonate which was consumed in neutralizing the daily acid load. And the distal convoluted tubule is very important, as we shall see further. Now this is validity of ABG report. Is the ABG correct? So I'm sure most of you would know this. This is on top, H is equal to 24 into PCO2 into HCO3, right? This is the Henderson-Lesselbeck equation. And you put the numbers here, you get the hydrogen ion, and 80 minus the number of hydrogen ions you are getting is added in the last two digits after 7, and that gives you the pH. And if this pH is same as the pH you are getting, then you assume that the ABG is correct, as shown in the example here. However, it can happen that the PCO2 and the hydrogen ions are both measured wrong, and they change in such a fashion that they cancel out the changes which are occurring. And you may get a correct, or rather a falsely correct answer with your Henderson-Hasselbeck equation to the ABG. This can also happen because the bicarbonate is actually not measured. The bicarbonate comes from PCO2 and hydrogen ions. So if the hydrogen ions, suppose, increase by 1.5, and the PCO2 also changes by a factor of 1.5, then they will cancel out and you will get a wrong value, but the equation will not show you. So what is to be done? What is the final answer here? So the final answer here is you have to check the bicarbonate that you are getting in the ABG with the serum bicarbonate from the biochemistry value. That is the blood value you send to the lab. And this should be within plus minus 2 of your ABG bicarbonate. If that is there, then your ABG is correct. Now we shall move on to the different types of bicarbonates and base excess that we have. So this is what is normally there in the ABG. HCO3 actual, HCO3 standard, base excess B, that is blood, base excess ECF, that is base excess extracellular fluid. Now, what is all this? These are the two which we actually need, that's all. The other two are redundant. So, the first definition, do you know which one is this? This is actual bicarbonate. And the second definition, what is this? This is standard bicarbonate. And it is the actual bicarbonate that we use. Standard bicarbonate is not really relevant, but it is there because of historical reasons. Some of the ABG machines still give it. And this is the definition of actual base excess, which is also base blood. Base B stands for base blood. And this is standard base excess. So the difference between standard base excess and actual base excess is that standard base excess also takes into account the buffering which is being done by the extracellular fluid and is more precise. So if your machine is giving both of them, then use standard base excess. Don't use base excess actual or base excess blood. But sometimes the machine gives only one base excess, so you have to use that. But you should be aware of these differences, and there can be a significant difference between your actual base excess and your standard base excess. And standard base excess is the one which is recommended. So this just shows you, if you can have a look at what I've highlighted. There's buffered base, which is used in Stewart's method. And then we have the actual bicarbonate. And as you can see, it includes obtained from blood gas analyzers, calculated according to complex formula. And then you have your standard base excess, which is BESF, extracellular fluid, and is more representative than BE blood. And it takes into account non-bicarbonate buffering in extracellular fluid. So that is just to show you the evidence here. And this is what is being practiced even in Harvard labs. This is just something I have found in one of the textbooks. And this is being done in Harvard labs also. Now, moving on to the ABGs. How to know which is the primary abnormality and which is compensation? So it is generally very easy when the pH is altered. But when the pH is normal, like here, which is the primary abnormality? So the way to find out is actually by these steps. You look for the primary change by finding out the percent deviation of bicarbonate and PCO2, whichever is more. Okay, so whichever is more is the primary deviation. And how do you find out the primary deviation? By looking at the percentage change in bicarbonate and the percentage change in PCO2. And the change or the deviation is calculated using bicarbonate as 24 and PCO2 as 40. That is for all calculations. Bicarbonate is normally 22 to 26 and PCO2 is given as 36 to 44 or 38 to 42. But the value you take is 24 for bicarbonate, and for PCO2 you use 40 when you calculate. So if you just try to apply this here, now, you look for the percentage change. Now, what I was telling you was for the primary deviation. What is the primary deviation? So the change in the carbon dioxide is 10, 50 minus 40, and the change in HCO3 is 28 minus 24, that is 4. So the percentage change is 10 by 40, that is 25% in PCO2, and this is 4 by 24, which is approximately 17%. So the primary deviation is PCO2 because the percentage change in PCO2 is more than bicarbonate. So the primary disorder is a respiratory acidosis. And the bicarbonate is compensatory, or it may be changing because of a metabolic process. So that is the final way to make out what is the primary disorder whenever there's a confusion. The other ways are quite simple. When there is a PCO2 rise and the pH decreases, you know it is a respiratory disorder. And the other situation similar. So I hope I was able to clarify this. This is an important concept. Now, there are many formulae in ABG analysis, and it is mind-boggling to say the least, and it is actually frightening to some extent that I have to know so many formulae. But the ones I've highlighted in the box are all you need actually. The rest, if you want to know them, you can know them. They have a small incremental importance, but this is what you should know. These six equations have to be known. Without this, you cannot interpret the ABG, and I have seen my residents and the young intensivists often do not know this. Unless you know these formulae, and these formulae are the compensations. Unless you know them, you cannot interpret the ABG. You will be looking only at the PO2 or the PCO2 or whether there's some pH change. But to get answers, clinical understanding from the ABG, you have to know these six equations. Now, often we have to calculate delta gap. Okay, so for calculating delta anion gap, AG is taken as 10. Anion gap, if you want to, you know, use as a tool, then you take it as 10. Like I told you, carbon dioxide is taken as 40. So anion gap, you have to take as 10 because normal is 8 to 12. And then you can also look at the anion gap of your lab. It is very important. Each lab has its own anion gap, and this can vary from machine to machine. So this is a caveat in anion gap analysis. Though the standardized anion gap is 8 to 12, right? But it can vary in different labs, in different machines, and the ABG printout should list what is the anion gap for that particular machine. That is also very important to know, which we don't realize. Now, can there be overcompensation? Can there be overcompensation, and what does that mean? Look at this example. There is marked increase in PCO2 suggestive of respiratory acidosis, and it looks like chronic respiratory acidosis because the bicarbonate has gone up, which is compensating. So I told you earlier that when there is compensation, the pH does not return to normal in acute respiratory acidosis, acute respiratory alkalosis, metabolic acidosis, metabolic alkalosis. There'll be a secondary change in your bicarbonate or your CO2, but that will only stop the acidosis or alkalosis from worsening in terms of its pH, but not return it towards normal. It is only in chronic respiratory alkalosis and chronic respiratory acidosis that your pH will return to normal. Now, let us take this example. This is chronic respiratory acidosis with compensation, fully compensated because the expected rise of bicarbonate is fully present. Now the pH in respiratory acidosis should be less than 7.4, right? It should be between 7.35 to 7.4 because there is a respiratory acidosis. That is what one would think. But it can go towards 7.45. It will not go beyond 7.45. Okay? Because the normal pH is 7.35 to 7.45. So at times you can get a pH which is going towards the other side, but it will not cross the normal limits in fully compensated strains, and vice versa in chronic respiratory alkalosis. So in respiratory acidosis, as here, you can get a pH which is anywhere between 7.35 to 7.45. Normally, it will be between 7.35 and 7.4. This is very important to understand. I have shown you an example of chronic respiratory acidosis. Similarly, you can have it in chronic respiratory alkalosis. Now, just to show you an example, have a look at this. pH, PCO2, and your bicarbonate. So this is what? This is respiratory acidosis being compensated. Right? The pH is 7.38, PCO2 82, and your bicarbonate 48. Now, what is the compensation for chronic respiratory acidosis? It is a rise of 4 to 5 of bicarbonate for every 10 of PCO2. So there's a rise of 40 approximately in PCO2. So 4 into 5 means there should be a rise in bicarbonate. So that should give you 24 plus 20, 44 of bicarbonate. Okay, but here the bicarbonate is 48. It is more. Now the question is, why is the bicarbonate so high? Normally, it cannot cross around 40 to 42. That is the limits of compensation for chronic respiratory acidosis. There are limits to compensation in extreme cases. So this is an extreme case of chronic respiratory acidosis. And when there is extreme compensation, the values for compensation in terms of your bicarbonate or your CO2 can actually go away from the normal equations that we have. We do not know the exact values, and the values that are given for compensation have a confidence limit of 95% plus minus 5%. So as we go further and further towards the extreme, you can have deviations from normal. Now, some of you may ask why this is not metabolic alkalosis being superimposed. So if this was metabolic acidosis being superimposed on your compensation of bicarbonate, then your pH would go towards 7.45. It will not remain 7.38. Another question that some of you may ask is why is this not metabolic alkalosis with respiratory acidosis? So that again is incorrect, because if there is metabolic alkalosis, then the compensation is not there if you take the CO2. The PCO2 is much higher than the compensation. And if it was primarily metabolic alkalosis, the pH would be alkaline. So this is a very good ABG. And another answer here is, whether your machine is calibrated because it is giving a higher bicarbonate than your expected bicarbonate. The expected bicarbonate here is 44 and it is giving 48.5. But my understanding and my interpretation is that this is extreme compensation, and in extreme compensation, you can get some deviations in the expected rise of HCO3 and similarly in other disorders. This is just to substantiate what I just told you. Kindly read the highlighted portion and you will understand. So you can see that clinical studies cannot be conducted to construct confidence limits in extreme deviations in respiratory alkalosis or acidosis, and the compensation can be greater than 7.4 in chronic respiratory acidosis. Now, moving on to metabolic acidosis. Now, how does metabolic acidosis occur? It occurs in two ways. Either there is increased cellular metabolic production of acid, or there is loss of alkali through the kidney or through the GI tract, or the kidney is unable to generate the normal amount of bicarbonate that it has to every day. So these are, broadly speaking, the classes or the mechanisms by which you get metabolic acidosis. So these are the common causes of normal anion gap metabolic acidosis, and these are the rare causes. Now, diarrhea, adrenals, fistulas, they can remove alkaline fluid, so you get acidosis. Saline infusions, because you give a lot of chloride and chloride replaces bicarbonate because you have to maintain electroneutrality. Then renal failure with a GFR of more than 30. Please note, GFR more than 30 is NAGMA. Then hyperkalemia, because hyperkalemia is related to transcellular shifts and also occurs at the tubular levels in the kidneys. Then type 4 RTA, that is renal tubular acidosis occurring in diabetic nephropathy with a normal or an abnormal creatinine because of altered aldosterone in the distal tubules, and sometimes with TPN, if you are giving a lot of amino acids, then metabolism leads to acid production. Then distal and proximal RTA, ureter sigmoidostomy, because when the urine is drained into the colonic loop, there's an exchange of chloride and bicarbonate leading to bicarbonate loss from the your fluid. And then you have similarly in jejunal and SI loops because of chloride and bicarbonate exchange. Then certain kinds of kidney disease, which are known as tubulointerstitial disease, even with a lower GFR than 30, they can have NAGMA. And there are many drugs which can cause NAGMA. This here is high anion gap metabolic acidosis, common causes and rare causes. As GFR drops to less than 30 in acute kidney injury, as well as in CKD, the NAGMA goes into HAGMA. This is important to know. Many of you will probably not know this, but this is renal failure. The GFR is important. Then, if you have an unexplained high anion gap metabolic acidosis and the diagnosis is not clear, do think of poisonings. And mud piles is a useful mnemonic, and gold mark is a new mnemonic for NAGMA. Now, what is the diagnosis here? this patient has acidosis. That much I'll tell you. Can you give me the diagnosis? This is showing nephrocalcinosis. And the diagnosis here is distal renal tubular acidosis. Now, what is the mechanism for acid secretion that we normally produce every day, or if there is acid load on the human body? So what happens is bicarbonate is absorbed. This is the filtered bicarbonate that you normally have in your serum. And then the hydrogen ions are complex to hydrogen phosphate and ammonia and excreted out. And in the process of ammonia generation and binding to hydrogen, you get bicarbonate generation. And this bicarbonate is then carried away in your bloodstream. I will just repeat that. You see, you have bicarbonate coming and it goes here in the proximal tubules, carried away by absorption. So you regenerate the filtered bicarbonate, then hydrogen ion comes down all the way, binds to hydrogen phosphate and ammonia and is excreted, bound to these anions. And at the same time, you get bicarbonate generation here in this process of ammonia generation, and bicarbonate is then reclaimed. This is the bicarbonate which was consumed in neutralizing the daily acid load and to some extent the acid load that is produced in pathological conditions. Now, this is unmeasured anions minus unmeasured cations, which is the anion gap. That is 8 to 12. So these are the causes, as all of you will know. And sometimes patients are on lithium. Lithium is a cation and it contributes to the anion gap, and myeloma proteins also are cations, which can have a significant impact on your anion gap. So please remember that there is no actual anion gap. It is only a concept. I will just explain that to you. So this is something about anions and cations. A question for you is, what is the net charge on the surface of your body? Think about it as we move on. So I'll just break for 2 minutes here and carry on with the rest of the lecture. It will take another 45 minutes or 50 minutes to complete it, and it's a little tiring. So I'll just have a glass of water, break for 2 minutes and restart. So, Manish. So now guys, we will move on to gaps in anion gap and delta gap. There are many caveats to anion gap and delta gap. And we shall try and understand, as many of you may have realized, that there are problems when you try to compute the anion gap and delta gap. Now, I assume you know the basics about anion gap and delta gap. And I covered this in my earlier lecture, so I will not cover the basics. So why the correction for low albumin and similarly phosphate? Albumin contributes to 75% of the unmeasured anions, and after that it is phosphate. So at the very outset, phosphate itself, you know, normal phosphate is 4. If you have a phosphate of 1, then we never correct for phosphate. Though there are formula if you go into the depth of anion gap analysis. So that itself would lead to an altered value of anion gap in severe hypophosphatemia. But let us talk about albumin and let the phosphate be kept aside, because we do not correct it, and primarily because the changes in phosphate are not so severe, but it does contribute to anion gap. So the correction for low albumin. Now, this is a Gamble gram described by Dr. Gamble in 1939, who first constructed this. And as you can see, the cations and the anions, they are equal because of the law of electroneutrality in the human body. The anions have to be equal to cations because we have to be electrically neutral. The body surface has to be electrically neutral. Now, what is anion gap? It is sodium minus chloride plus bicarbonate, which is this. And if you look at it at another way, it is your unmeasured anions minus your unmeasured cations, right? So I think that is very clear, and that is your anion gap here as seen. Now, the question is, why should we correct for albumin, and what happens when albumin becomes low? So your albumin has disappeared, okay? But when your albumin is disappearing, this anion gap actually decreases. This actually decreases, okay? Now the question here is, we correct for albumin. You know the formula very well. For every decrease of albumin below 4.5, we add 2.5 for negative charge. Now, this is the situation. There is no albumin. So what is the anion gap? Unmeasured anions minus unmeasured cations, which is almost equal. I mean, there is no gap as such. The albumin has disappeared. That is why you have to correct for albumin, because if you are getting an anion gap acidosis like lactic acidosis here, you will not be able to discern that there is lactic acidosis. Therefore, you correct for albumin because all your equations are based on these particular formulae. Otherwise, like I told you, you will not be able to discern the difference. But another concept to be understood is that when the albumin decreases, the gap actually decreases. The second question is, what happens to the charge? Albumin is negatively charged, right? So if albumin is decreasing, the positive charge, that is all your cations, are more than your anions, because albumin is an anion. So what happens is, there's a redistribution of ions and cations, which maintains electrical neutrality. But you have to correct for albumin, otherwise you will not be able to make out the high anion gap acidosis that you are actually occurring, and that is namely your lactic acidosis or your decay, because your equations are framed in such a fashion. Now, what about chloride? Something we don't talk about. It's a very important molecule, and you know, it's so abundant, the normal range being around 100 milliequivalents. After sodium, it is the most abundant molecule in the blood. So when there is a chloride change, there are only three causes. One is, you look at your sodium. If your sodium is moving in the same direction as chloride, the chloride is related to sodium. If there is hyponatremia, there will be increased chloride. If there is hyponatremia, there will be decreased chloride, because sodium and chloride absorption is linked in the renal tubules. One. Second, you can look at your bicarbonate. Bicarbonate and chloride are linked, because if bicarbonate is increasing, then your chloride will decrease. This is again related to the fact that both are negatively charged and to the processes in the renal tubules. This is what happens in your hyperchloremic acidosis. You lose bicarbonate, but you increase your chloride. So that is the second thing that you look at when you try to explain increased chloride or decreased chloride. And then if both your sodium and your bicarbonate are not giving the answer, then you look at your cations, your calcium, your magnesium. If these are increasing, then again your chloride will increase, because the cations have to be equal to anions. So to answer changes in chloride, look at sodium, look at bicarbonate, and look at your calcium and magnesium if your sodium and bicarbonate are not giving the answer. Now, lactic acidosis, something which we deal with every day, something which is so familiar to us, and something which is so controversial in terms of ABG analysis. We have all seen that sometimes there is high lactate, but there is no acidosis. There is no increase in anion gap, though the lactic acidosis is a classic example of increased anion gap acidosis. And the delta gap, which in high anion gap should be 1 in lactic acidosis, is classically 1:2, not 1. So what happens in lactic acidosis? 1, you may not get acidosis if there is a coexisting alkalosis. 2, there may be renal clearance of acid load, but lactate is not filtered through the renal tubules. There is filtration normally also of the lactate molecule through the kidneys, but the acid clearance is much more than that of lactate molecule. Then the apparent space of distribution of protons is more. Okay, please note, when you have lactic acidosis, the body does not produce lactic acid. The chemical reactions in the body produce lactate separately and protons are produced separately. But for every lactate molecule, a proton is produced. The biochemistry is such. And the space of distribution of the hydrogen ions or the protons, whatever you want to call it, is much more than that of lactate. Thereby, the hydrogen ion concentration is not changed that much in your blood. Then other anions and cations may alter the anion gap. When there is lactic acidosis, there's a complex disarray in the biochemistry and the bioenergetics. And other anions and cations are produced, which may alter the anion gap. And it has been seen and proven that 50% of mild to moderate lactic acidosis patients do not have increased anion gap. And this is something which all of you have seen. And the answer is this. But if the lactic acidosis is severe, that is going beyond something like 8-9 levels of lactate, you will get some anion gap, provided there are no other complicating factors. And because of these incongruences that we have in our physical method of ABG analysis, the strong ion difference concept, that is a Stewart's approach, is used by some of the intensivists because it is more accurate in these situations. So therein lies the gaps in your anion gap and your delta gap. And this here is just to show you something about the Stewart's approach being applied to lactate analysis. And this is by none other than Gattinoni, who is one of the world's foremost intensivists. So he himself has using the Stewart approach to explain this. And this here is actually another paper from Journal of Society of Nephrology. And here you can see it says that Forni et al. In a group of intensive care unit patients with lactic acidosis, DKA, acidosis of unknown cause, noted the presence of significant amounts of Krebs cycle intermediates, and these metabolites accounted for some but not of all the anions. So it is a very complex situation, and these are the answers to the queries you must have had when looking at patients with lactic acidosis. And some more evidence here, you can see, this is a classic paper by Gabo, Patricia Gabo, who has done a lot of work on anion gap and published in New England Journal of Medicine way back in 1980, but this is a classic paper. And in this, they analyzed the biochemistry and the acidosis in 57 hospitalized patients. They saw that in 10 of 35 patients, with anion gap of 20 to 29, there was no lactic acidosis or ketoacidosis. And then they also saw changes in equivalents of total proteins, phosphorus, potassium, calcium accounted for 15%, what I was telling you. And in 9 patients, it was unexplainable. So guys, these are the caveats with anion gap and delta gap, and that is why we are not able to get exact values. And these are, I think, some of the answers which you are seeking, and I think I have been able to help you with. Please remember that anion gap and delta gap are not always precise. Look at the patient, look at the clinical picture, and don't try to just use the anion gap and delta gap in diagnosing a particular medical condition. Now, moving on to diabetic ketoacidosis. So for the diagnosis of diabetic ketoacidosis, you should have a blood sugar of more than 250, and your ketones should generally be positive in the urine. And it depends on what kind of urine sticks you are using and whether you're using blood ketones. Blood ketones will always be increased, and urine sticks may show only mild because of the different nature of acetones that are detected. You are all aware of that. Then the anion gap will always be increased. The very important point is in DK that the anion gap will always be increased. That is very important. And the pH should be acidotic, but the pH can be normal in DK. Supposing the patient has a lot of vomitings, or because of some pre-existing alkalosis, he develops DK, his pH will be normal, right? So classically, when the textbooks describe that the pH should be acidotic or less than 7.3, they're talking about a patient who's normal previously. But if there is another concomitant condition causing alkalosis, or the patient is alkalotic from before, then your pH may be normal. But the hallmark is the blood sugar will be increased, and more importantly, anion gap will always be increased. And the ketones, if not in the urine because of faulty sticks, or because you know the ketones don't always detect acetoacetate and they miss out on hydroxybutyrate, your ketones may not be picked up by your urine sticks. Your ketonemia will always be there, and many labs are measuring blood ketones now. Now, coming to blood sugar, can you get DK with normal blood sugars? Yes. So there are conditions, some of you may know, that you can have DK with normal blood sugars, and these are related to alcoholism, to pregnancy, to patients with liver disease, and to SLG2 inhibitors, and maybe a few more conditions. So you can get euglycemic DK. Now, as far as the resolution of DK is concerned, the most important thing is, again, that the blood sugar should return to normal if it was elevated less than 200, and your anion gap should become normal. These are the two most important things for resolution of DK, and your pH should start improving, and your bicarbonate should be increasing towards normal. But they don't have to be normal. But yes, the blood sugar should be less than 250, and your anion gap should be normal. That is resolution of DK. Now, the acidosis in DK. The delta gap is normally 1. It can be little more, little less. Then as high anion gap resolves, you get a low anion gap. So the pH may not improve that much. Therefore, you should follow the anion gap. And NAGMA occurs because you give a lot of saline, and that gives a lot of chloride. So increasing chloride levels lead to NAGMA, and thereby the pH does not improve that much, and anion gap should be followed. The other thing is, as the biochemistry improves, as the DK is coming under control, the ketones get metabolized to bicarbonate. This is known as potential bicarbonate molecules. Molecules like ketones and lactate, they are known as potential bicarbonate because when there is resolution of the underlying disease, the metabolism of ketones and lactate gives rise to bicarbonate. May sound something new to you, but that is what is meant by the word potential bicarbonate, which all of you may have read. Then correction of pH is done only if less than 7, and delta gap may be more than 1 in certain situations. For example, if there's lactic acidosis associated with it, and you correct the phosphate and magnesium only if it is severe. Now, as far as the pH is concerned, if it is less than 7, you correct with 50 ml soda bicarb in 200 ml of water with 10 milliequivalents of KCl per hour till pH is more than 7. It should not cross, 7.1. 7 is what you want. If you are 7, you are happy. And this is given over a period of 2 hours. So this is an American Diabetic Association recommendation, and I've seen people correcting diabetic ketoacidosis with a pH of 7, 7.2. Please do not do that. It is detrimental. And studies have shown that there is no benefit. If you give bicarbonate, it leads to delayed resolution of ketosis. It worsens the hypokalemia, which is often persisting in these patients. There is a decreased O2 uptake because it affects the O2-HB dissociation, and it puts especially the younger patients at the risk of cerebral edema. So you need a pH of 7. Now, this is just to show you the transition from a delta gap of 1 to a delta gap of 0.75. So a delta gap of 1 means that there is the decay with high anion gap acidosis. And when you have a delta gap of less than 1, that means you have high anion gap acidosis combining with a normal anion gap. So as you give saline, your high anion gap resolves and it gets resolved, but you get a normal anion gap acidosis. So your delta gap starts falling. Now, just to complete the ketosis, we have starvation ketosis and alcoholic ketosis. So starvation ketosis is a mild form of ketosis with the bicarbonate more than 18, does not go beyond that. And it can occur within 48 hours of fasting. Ketones urine can be positive, and it's a mild acidosis. So sometimes if you get an unexplained bicarbonate of 18, 19, and patient gets admitted to the ICU, it is often starvation ketosis, which we don't realize. Patient gets sick, he's not eaten for 2-3 days, and he can be in starvation ketosis. Another condition is alcoholic ketosis, which is poorly understood in terms of its biochemistry. It is associated with binge drinking and vomiting, pain, abdomen are its hallmarks. But it is often a mixed disorder because there is often hepatic encephalopathy in these patients, or because of vomiting, they have alkalosis. So you get a mixed ABG in this patient in terms of the ABG disorders. And classically, ketones are negative in these patients initially. So you may miss the diagnosis unless you suspect it and do a blood ketone level. And finally, ketones do become positive because the nature of ketones change. And this is a difficult diagnosis to make sometimes, but do suspect it when you are getting a patient like this. And the treatment is very simple. You really don't have to do too much. It is because of the alcohol and the altered biochemistry. You just have to give the DNS solution to this patient and manage the alcoholism. Now, coming to renal failure, which is very again important to us again, I've talked about lactic acidosis, decay, now about renal failure. So I told you earlier that above a GFR of 30, it is normal anion gap, and GFR of less than 30 is high anion gap acidosis in renal failure. So this is just to show you an example of normal anion gap where the GFR is 40 and the creatinine is not too much elevated. And this happens because the anions, that is phosphate and sulfate, are not retained in the early stages of renal failure. And it is the retention of phosphate and sulfate which leads to higher anion gap. Now, as it worsens, that is your GFR worsens, your anion gap starts increasing and you get high anion gap metabolic acidosis. Now, what are the clinical features of metabolic acidosis and why do they occur? So as far as why they occur has not been worked out, but the clinical features which you are aware of are very significant because pH of 7.1, 7.15, patient sick is not good at all for us. Now, we have all seen this, and there is vasodilatation, myocardial depression, decreased response to catecholamines, hypotension. This is what starts happening. Patients are on vasopressors often. So we know this. But very important to realize is that these patients have an increased respiratory drive because they are trying to compensate and wash out the CO2. And the work of breathing is increased. And this becomes very important in weaning also. Because if you try to wean and extubate a patient who is in metabolic acidosis, you are adding to his work of breathing. So ideally, the pH should be near normal when you try to extubate. And also, increasing acidosis leads to lethargy and obtundation. So coming to the treatment of metabolic acidosis. So this is the latest guideline published 1 month ago. And for lactic acidosis, they have recommended against the use of soda bicarb. And for AKI, they recommend soda bicarb therapy because it actually has been shown to delay RRT, to improve mortality, and to improve outcomes. So this actually comes after this bicarb ICU study published some time ago, extensive study on metabolic acidosis patients. Predominantly, they were having either sepsis or renal failure, but there were other patients also with other kinds of metabolic acidosis. And this study found that in patients with renal failure, that is acute kidney injury, giving bicarbonate to patients with pH of less than 7.2 and maintaining at around 7.3, the outcome was improved, including mortality. And this has to be borne in mind. And I've not put up the details of this study, but you should go through this study. And as far as lactic acidosis is concerned, I've shown you the guidelines by the surviving sepsis. And expert opinion says that for a pH of less than 7.2, one should dialyze the patient. That is the best way to treat lactic acidosis, which is severe. And do not give bicarbonate because there is no data to support it. Actually, it may worsen the condition. Now, that was about treatment of DK, lactic acidosis, and renal failure. Now, what about treatment for normal anion gap? So you see, if you look at the causes of normal anion gap, there are many causes which are of a chronic nature. The acute nature is in terms of diarrhea and certain other conditions. So there are no clear guidelines, but generally, expert opinion says that if the pH is dropping to 7.1, 7.2, then you should replace with bicarbonate. And you can give 100 ml bolus of 7.5% bicarbonate, which is normally available. One ampule of 7.5% bicarbonate, 50 ml, has 44 milliequivalents of sodium and 44 milliequivalents of bicarbonate. So you can give 100 ml bolus and repeat the ABG after 2 hours and give another 100 ml bolus. Alternatively, you can use bicarb infusions also, But please remember that when you give bicarbonate infusions, these are hyper osmolar infusions, and it increases the sodium, and there will be a tendency towards hypernatremia. So infusions are ideally diluted in 5% dextrose if the body allows, that is, the patient allows volume to be given to the patient. But there are other problems also with the alkali correction by giving bicarb, that is, you get hypocalcemia and you get volume overload, and like I told you, you get hypernatremia and you get hypocalcemia. So these are inherent problems with giving bicarb. And there are PO formulation also. There is salt solution, there is soda bicarbonate tablet, and there is no definite formula for correction. One formula is that standard base excess into 0.3 of the total body weight is the estimated bicarbonate that you need to give. But because the process of acidosis is ongoing, you cannot have an absolute formula. You know, whatever bicarb you give will be consumed to some extent. That is why there is no definite formula. But if the acidosis has been correct, has stopped, then if you give around 100 ml, it is supposed to increase the serum bicarbonate by around 2 to 3 if you measure it at around 2 hours. You know, it takes a while for the bicarbonate to distribute across the body. Therefore, you should actually measure it after 2 hours to get the actual change in your serum bicarbonate. And of course, then you should correct the underlying disorder. So we move on to metabolic alkalosis now. So this is actually a patient with metabolic alkalosis. As you can see, bicarbonate is extremely high, and there is a compensatory rise in PCO2. And urine chloride is 13. So what are you going to do with this patient? Just like that. Well, how are you going to treat him? But this patient needs saline. A metabolic alkalosis with a low urine chloride is treated with saline. We shall discuss this, and I shall show you metabolic alkalosis. So this is the classic setting for metabolic alkalosis: patient with poor intake, vomiting, diarrhea, hypovolemia, hypokalemia, low urine chloride. The other setting, which is very common, is a patient of COPD on steroids, on diuretics, and fluid restriction because he has right heart failure due to chorpulmonale. So these are the two very common scenarios for metabolic alkalosis. And please remember, diuretics, patient keep getting diuretics, and they go into metabolic alkalosis, patient keep getting steroids. These contribute to metabolic alkalosis. These examples contribute to around 25 to 50% of the metabolic alkalosis that we see in our ICU. So the physiology of metabolic alkalosis is divided into two groups. Either there is a loss of volume and there is a secondary generation of bicarbonate, or there is a primary increased production of bicarbonate. And aldosterone is a key hormone in metabolic alkalosis. Now, this is a picture of a patient with metabolic alkalosis. Can you give me the diagnosis by looking at the picture? We had this patient. I mean, this is not the picture of that particular patient, but a very similar patient, the same disease we had, presented to us with metabolic alkalosis. So the diagnosis here is this is the ABG, and this patient came to us with this ABG. And he had seizures when he came to the ER. So the diagnosis here is Cushing's disease, because he is having obesity, he is having moon-shaped faces, And if you see the abdomen, there are purple striae. So this is a case of Cushing's disease where there's excess aldosterone activity and there is metabolic alkalosis. Now, coming to the causes of metabolic alkalosis, there are two groups and they can be divided into volume contracted, low potassium, normotension, or volume expanded, hypertension and low potassium. Here you have GI causes and then the renal causes. Please note post hypercapnic alkalosis, that is something I'll talk about, and rare causes of Bartter's and Gitelman. And then here you have your condition, which are primarily because of increased aldosterone production or mineralocorticoid activity. And there is the rare disorder of Liddle syndrome. So these are the two groups. And if you get a patient with metabolic alkalosis, you have to consider these two groups. And history of hypertension is always helpful because the group on the right has hypertension most of the times. So that is very important. The other thing is you can look at the potassium and you can look at the urine chloride, which I shall show you. But before that, please remember bicarb infusions and citrate infusions and ringer lactate also produce metabolic alkalosis. Citrate and ringer lactate get metabolized to bicarbonate and thereby contribute to alkalosis. So once you are actually getting your metabolic alkalosis, it is very easy for the kidney to lose the alkali or the bicarbonate in the urine. Okay, the problem for the kidney is to counter acidosis. There is no problem in losing alkali because you are filtering bicarbonate, the kidney can just let it filter through and your alkalosis will be corrected. But because there is something which maintains the alkalosis, the kidney is not able to counter the alkalosis by losing bicarbonate. And this is called the maintenance phase of metabolic alkalosis. And this is because of increased aldosterone production. And increased aldosterone production occurs in both the broad groups, that is the volume contraction alkalosis or the conditions associated with primary hyperaldosteronism, which I just showed you. I showed you the two groups. So if this process is going on, which is the process of increased aldosterone production, your alkalosis will not get corrected. So what is the physiology of metabolic alkalosis in the renal tubules? So normally bicarbonate is produced. It is absorbed here and it is absorbed in the distal tubules. And there is increased aldosterone production and the function of aldosterone is to absorb sodium and water. And in the same process, it actually adds bicarbonate to your blood. It leads to sodium and water retention as well as hypokalemic alkalosis. So, if you have to counter the aldosterone production, either you give saline and correct the volume contraction, or you remove the primary condition, which I showed you, which is causing aldosteronism, like or mineralocorticoid activity. So what are the clinical features of your metabolic alkalosis? So these are hypolemia, paresthesias, muscle spasm, confusion, obtundation, seizures because of decrease in ionized calcium, which occurs with metabolic alkalosis. Then you can get arrhythmias, hypokalemia, and very important is alveolar hypoventilation. That is because for compensation of metabolic alkalosis, your PCO2 has to go up. So the alveolar ventilation or your minute ventilation decreases. And thereby your PO2 levels also drop. So this is very important. Because if the patient is having a baseline hypoxia and he develops a decreased minute ventilation, his hypoxia can worsen. So this we should be careful about. Now, the role of urine chloride in metabolic alkalosis is to distinguish the two groups, that is one group which is saline responsive and the other group which is not saline responsive. So the urine chloride value of more than 20 and less than 20 is taken as the cutoff, and the highlighted group in the box is chloride responsive here. So this is gastric fluid loss, diuretics, but diuretics should be, you know, not just started. That time the chloride can be different. They should have been on chronic diuretic use or a few days. Then post hypercapnic alkalosis, that is when you wash out your CO2 in COPD patients or type 2 respiratory failure, and your villous adenoma tumors. These are not so common, and non-absorbable anion delivery also not common, which occurs with certain antibiotics. And rest of the conditions are actually related to increased aldosterone because of primary increase in aldosterone, or renin increase because of, you know, tumors or renal vascular hypertension. And I already told you about Cushing syndrome, then you have Bartter's, Gittleman's, and so on and so forth. And many of these conditions will have hypertension. So this was about, you know, metabolic alkalosis and the treatment for metabolic alkalosis now. Now, Diamox, that is acetazolamide, is an important drug because if you cannot correct your alkalosis with saline, because the saline may be contraindicated to the patient in CHF or whatever reason, then Diamox helps in countering the metabolic acidosis, alkalosis, because it produces metabolic acidosis by acting on the renal tubules. You can give around 250 BD to the patient. It comes in a tablet form and it counters the alkalosis. And similarly, you may also use your manipulation with dialysis. Sometimes if required, that depends on the situation. But correction of potassium is very important. So I think that should be clear about the management and the use of chloride and the different two subgroups of metabolic alkalosis. Now moving on to respiratory disorders. So we have another 15-20 minutes of the session. So I hope you're not getting tired. I will just take another 15-20 minutes, but this is to just make it very comprehensive so that there is nothing left in ABG and you people get to know everything by the end of this lecture. So, time is very important in respiratory disorders because you have to distinguish between acute and chronic, unlike metabolic disorders where there's only metabolic alkalosis and acidosis. Here we have acute and chronic respiratory alkalosis and acidosis. So, time is a key factor you have to distinguish. Acute respiratory acidosis, pH is never completely corrected. You should know the correction formula, the compensation formula, and the respiratory acidosis is compensated for by a decrease in bicarbonate, but the pH does not return to normal, and there is acute hypercapnia. We shall talk about hypercapnia as we move on. Now, this is how the compensation for respiratory acidosis occurs. There is an increase in CO2, and this enters the RBC. And here you can see the hydrogen ion and the bicarbonate ion. The hydrogen binds to hemoglobin, and bicarbonate is shunted out into the bloodstream. So that is the immediate buffering which occurs for acute respiratory acidosis. And this is chemical buffering, which I showed you in the beginning. This is the instantaneous chemical buffering. Ultimately, if the respiratory acidosis persists full compensation actually comes from the kidney. This process occurs over a minute to a few minutes to a few hours and is complete. But the complete compensation takes 2 to 5 days if your respiratory acidosis persists and goes from acute to chronic. Now, if you look at this picture, what do you observe? Don't look at the tongue. The tongue is not really indicative. Look at the eyes. So the eyes are a little red. Agreed? So that is a patient of COPD, and classically they have somewhat of suffused conjunctiva, that is reddish eyes, and that is because of hypercapnia, chronic hypercapnia. Because chronic hypercapnia leads to vasodilatation. And we shall talk about this as we move on. Now, very important thing is in chronic respiratory acidosis, you have significant hypercapnia and drowsiness. So what actually causes the CNS symptoms? Now, guys, there is no clear answer to this. Even today, we do not know that in conditions where there is hypercapnia and CO2 narcosis, why do you get drowsiness? There is no clear answer. There is some change in neurotransmitters. Beyond that, we do not know. Now, what is the relationship in hypercapnic failure to CO2 and pH, and are they important? Because we all know CO2 causes the symptoms, but what is the role of pH? So the role of pH is that pH actually acts as a brake to the symptoms that are caused by CO2. In chronic respiratory failure, whether it is COPD or another disorder, if there is hypercapnia and if it is compensated for by the pH, then the symptoms will not occur. For the symptoms to occur, your pH has to be acidotic, or there has to be an increase in PCO2 beyond compensation. You know, the kidneys cannot just keep on compensating for chronic respiratory acidosis. There are limits to compensation. And once you start crossing a PCO2 of 70 to 80, you will get symptoms because the compensation will fall. But as long as your chronic respiratory failure is compensated in terms of pH, you do not get the symptoms of hypercapnia to any great extent. So if you just look at this, this shows on the x-axis the PCO2 and on the y-axis the symptoms. So the green lines shows you the effect of acute hypercapnia, which start occurring immediately. By the time you get a PCO2 of around 60, the patient is obtunded and completely drowsy. And further progression can lead to even coma and death. Now, in chronic hypercapnia, the symptoms occur later once the PCO2 goes beyond 70, as because I told you it is generally compensated. But once it goes beyond that, you start going into obtundation, drowsiness, and coma. Now, I have seen that patients often, you know, go beyond 100 also in COPD. The maximum I have seen is 150 in a COPD patient, and that was a patient actually who was shifted to the ward after treatment for AECOPD, and he was receiving high flow oxygen. And he was found to be in coma, shifted down, we ventilated him. After seeing the ABG, his PCO2 was 150, pH was 6.8 or 6.9, and he recovered. So how high can the PCO2 go in chronic hypercapnic failure? It is not known. It has been recorded to be as high as 200 in the literature, especially in young patients without comorbidities, and these patients have made survival. So 150 I have seen myself, and classically in COPD, and these patients are actually put on excessive oxygen, which knocks off the hypoxic drive and leads to hypercapnia by other mechanisms also. So 150 is something which I've seen myself, and these patients have recovered. And other thing to realize about hypercapnia is there is individual variation in hypercapnia. different patients respond differently. Now, what are the symptoms apart from the classic symptoms of drowsiness, obtundation, and coma seen in the patients of chronic CO2 narcosis? You can also get tremors, you can get asterixis, and you can get headaches in these patients because of raised ICT, and ICT rises because there is cerebral vasodilatation. So apart from the neurological symptoms in patients of COPD or chronic hypercapnia, you also get alteration in your cerebral vasculature because of vasodilatation. And if the PCO2 goes very high, you get altered cerebral autoregulation. Now, hypercapnia also increases the sympathetic drive, leading to increased myocardial contractility, and it leads to plus minus increased heart rate. But the direct effect of hypercapnia is a dilatation of the blood vessels. The dilatation of the blood vessels counters the sympathetic drive, so the blood pressure actually remains normal, though there is a tendency towards increased cardiac output. And also on the pulmonary vasculature, it causes pulmonary vasoconstriction, leading to pulmonary hypertension. So that is the effects of hypercapnia on the CNS and on the vasculature, the two dominant symptoms that significant hypercapnia affects. Now, I've talked about overshoot alkalosis in my earlier slide, and I've talked about post-hypercapnic alkalosis. So what exactly is this? So this happens in a chronic type 2 respiratory failure or a patient with COPD admitted with acute exacerbation. So this is the ABG for the patient, if you can see on top. And if you actually ventilate the patients and blow out their CO2 rapidly, then the PCO2 will fall immediately, but the bicarbonate will not. So the pH will alter from one being acidotic to one being alkalotic. So this particular condition is called overshoot alkalosis or post-hypercapnic alkalosis. And it can lead to seizures, it can lead to arrhythmias. Therefore, your PCO2 should never be brought down rapidly. It should be lowered gently. So there is time for the pH to adjust. And often these patients of post-hypercapnic alkalosis are resistant to treatment of metabolic alkalosis, and you have to use saline if possible. Otherwise, you use some degree of acetazolamide. Now, coming to the last few slides, how does renal compensation for chronic respiratory acidosis occur? You know, there is renal compensation for chronic respiratory acidosis. So this is the mechanism. Normally, as I've showed you, bicarbonate is filtered through, it is absorbed. And then you have your hydrogen ions being filtered through, which will be bound to hydrogen phosphate and they get excreted. But at the same time, there is excess ammonia generation. There is excess ammonia generation because of increased PCO2. And this excessive ammonia generation leads to increased bicarbonate production. And this is the compensation which you have in these patients. It is the increased PCO2 which acts upon the renal tubules to increase the ammonia production. An offshoot of this is an increased bicarbonate production, which is the compensation for the chronic respiratory acidosis. And this process takes anywhere between 2 to 5 days. There is no fixed time for this, and that sometimes leads to problems with interpretation of ABG also, because you have to know whether it is acute or chronic when you are trying to use the equations. And vice versa occurs in your chronic respiratory alkalosis. Now, treatment of respiratory acidosis: treat the primary disease, keep the SATs 90, ventilatory support as required. Soda bicarb will help only if you can wash out the CO2. Otherwise, soda bicarb does not help. Tham is a molecule which counters acidosis and does not produce CO2, but is not available in our country. And please remember that there's an effect on the H2O dissociation in terms of respiratory acidosis. Now, when there is pure hypoventilation, right, you give some sedation and knock off the ventilation, or there is pure neuromuscular failure developing rapidly, you can actually determine how bad it is or what is happening by looking at the PCO2 and PO2, provided the lungs are normal. So when there is pure hypoventilation in a patient with normal lungs, for every decrease of 20 of O2, the PCO2 would have risen by 10. So this is a 10 by 20 formula. That is, for every PCO2 going up by 10, your O2O drops by 20 in a pure hypoventilation disorder with normal lungs. So this just helps you when you're trying to sort out things at the bedside. So these are some of the causes of acidosis. You can have a look at them. Just put it up for the sake of completeness. They are available everywhere. Now, acute respiratory alkalosis, again, you know, it's more or less the same in terms of its compensation. It is never complete, but the clinical features are a little different because, you know, there is cerebral vasoconstriction when your PCO2 goes down. And this actually leads to neuropsychiatric symptoms. And another thing is that it causes severe hypophosphatemia. Acute respiratory alkalosis can cause severe hypophosphatemia to the tune of phosphate less than 1. That is an important thing to remember. And then this disorder is also very common. You know, there are patients, especially young girls with this hyperventilation syndrome who are hyperventilating. The PCO2 is really low, going down to 10, 12, there's extreme alkalosis. And these patients are actually bordering on the lines of psychiatric disorders. And they are treated with, you know, the textbooks mentioned, they can be allowed to blow into a paper bag. So the CO2 accumulates in the paper bag and they breathe in paper bag. The other thing is you can give them a low dose of sedation. Do not over-sedate them, otherwise you will knock off the respiratory drive and put them on the ventilator. Low dose of sedation and probably a low dose of beta blocker can be given to decrease the sympathetic drive in these patients. So hyperventilation syndrome is something which you get in the emergency in certain situations sometimes. Then these are the conditions which lead to alkalosis and respiratory alkalosis. You can have a look at them. And this is a comprehensive list. I would like to mention two conditions here. One is hepatic encephalopathy and one is pregnancy. In hepatic encephalopathy, you know, you get a low PCO2 because the patient hyperventilates. A patient with hepatic encephalopathy, especially acute hepatic encephalopathy, hyperventilates and blows out its PCO2. And as he starts improving in terms of his sensorium, his PCO2 also starts improving. So this is something which I have seen and observed. This goes hand in hand. As the hepatic encephalopathy improves, the PCO2 level also goes on improving because the hepatic encephalopathy is associated with increased ICT. And as a reflex mechanism, the PCO2 is blown out so that there is cerebral vasoconstriction to decrease the ICT. Thereby, as the hepatic encephalopathy is improving, the ICT is decreasing, and thereby this reflex mechanism of washing out CO2 also decreases. And this is something which I've seen consistently in hepatic encephalopathy patients. And the second disorder is pregnancy, where you have a baseline respiratory alkalosis. Here, because of progesterone, Progesterone acts on the respiratory center in the brain, and these patients have some degree of hyperventilation, and they have mild respiratory alkalosis with a pH of around 7.44, 7.45, and their oxygen levels also are more than 100 sometimes. So this is a physiological AVG in pregnancy. Now, PCO2 acts on the respiratory center in the medulla, and this is a picture of the CO2 being high and then dissociating into hydrogen ions, which cross the blood-brain barrier and stimulate the respiratory center to hyperventilate. And here, if you see, this is the PCO2 level going up, this is the alveolar ventilation, and this is the PCO2. There is an increase in alveolar ventilation. Sorry, this is the green one. This is the increase in alveolar ventilation till a certain point of PCO2. But as the PCO2 starts going up, it starts depressing. So that is another feature. For some time, the PCO2 elevation will increase your alveolar ventilation. And once the PCO2 becomes really high, your alveolar ventilation will get suppressed. Now, just the last couple of slides, osmolar gap. So this is the formula for measured and calculated osmolarity, subtracted, and then more than 10 to 15 is abnormal. And how do you measure it? Measure is from the lab, and calculated is your 2 into sodium value from the serum plus glucose divided by 18 plus your blood urea divided by 5.6. It is given everywhere, and then you send the lab value and you measure it, and if it is more than 10 to 15, that is an increased osmolar gap. It can be found in pseudohyponatremia, which is due to hyperlipidemia or hyperproteinemia, if you have given a radiocontrast agent or mannitol. If none of this is there, then this helps in the diagnosis of certain poisonings, and these poisonings are mostly those which are associated with an elevated anion gap. So this is something which you should know, and this is actually more for the exams, because this kind of a question often comes in the exams and would be helpful to the students who are going to be taking exams. So we are finishing now. Thank you for your patient hearing and the last couple of slides. And this is the take-home message for all of you. First of all, pH usually stays towards the primary disorder in compensation, and it is very important to know this. At the same time, know that the normal pH is not 7.4, it is 7.35 to 7.45. Know the history, know the drugs, and know the baseline values of the patient, and look at the serial AVGs in the ICU compared to the previous ICU, and see what change has occurred between the two AVGs when you are not able to understand. There is no formula to estimate baseline PCO2 in ASCOPD. There are limits to compensation. The body cannot just go on compensating. There is a relationship between hyperkalemia and acidosis and hypokalemia and alkalosis. They go hand in hand because of shifts, transcellular shifts in the cells, as well as mechanisms in the renal tubules. Know your base. You need only your actual bicarbonate and your standard base excess. Calculate your anion gap in all ABGs, whether the ABG looks normal or not. Be aware of the changes that the pH can do on your weaning efforts, because acidosis increases the work of breathing and alkalosis depresses breathing, leading to CO2 retention and drowsiness. ABG and delta gap are not perfect and are to be taken with a pinch of salt. Realize the importance of pH on the O2-HB curve, especially when there is hypoxemic situations and the patient is sick, that is, there is criticality. It can have a significant impact on oxygen unloading. Alkalosis leads to decrease in ionized calcium, and ABG machines should regularly be calibrated. It is not at all uncommon that the machines are not uncalibrated and you are not getting the exact value. So, dear friends, with that, I think I have taken enough of your time. This is the same question which I had put up earlier, and you can actually see if you get the answer. The answer is 3. Correct answer is 3. Think about it. If you want to know why still, if you're not able to figure out, you can contact me. Just send a WhatsApp or mail or Telegram, or you can ask me. And this is one of my favorite quotes, you know. And this is our group from where we conduct our sessions. And I thank you all for your patient hearing. It has been an extremely long lecture. It has taken 2 hours, 10 minutes, and really patient hearing. Thank you so much. And let me look at the questions. So Dr. Manjunath, you have asked about the dose and duration of bicarb in septic shock. And I think I've already answered that. Lactic acidosis is not to be treated with bicarbonate, and renal failure recommendations I've shown you. And you have correctly answered Cushing's disease. That is very nice. And I think nephrocalcinosis also you have answered here, Dr. Manjunath, but the answer is renal tubular acidosis. You have correctly picked up nephrocalcinosis. And Dr. Pankaj has said neutral. So I really don't know to what he has said neutral. So I think that is the answers. I provided all the answers to you. And if there is any other question, I will wait for a couple of minutes. So friends, kindly go through this, and you are on different stages of your learning curve, and some of you may have followed the entire lecture, some of you may have followed parts of it. For those of you who have not been able to understand the complete lecture, try to go through the part one lecture, which is available on our channel, and the recording of this will be available soon. And if there are no more questions, I think I shall conclude the session. Thank you very much and see you again. Bye-bye. I thank the Cipla Pharmaceuticals also for providing the digital platform for this webinar. Thank you.